I have a problem with Hikigaya Hachiman, not with the character himself per se. I think he's a well-written, multifaceted, and unique character that stands out in a sea of mindless, self-insert light novel protagonists. But rather, I take issue with the way a certain contingent of the Oregairu fanbase views Hachiman. Inevitably, you will see no shortage of people in YouTube comments, Reddit threads, or wherever people discuss anime these days, where people express how much they relate to Hachiman, and how they think he's a great guy, and how they just want to be more like him. On the flip side, you have people who castigate Oregairu for being excessively edgy, and glorifying antisocial behavior. I can't help but feel like both of these groups of people have completely missed the point of Oregairu. It's pretty clear that if you idolize Hachiman and think he is someone worth emulating, you have grossly missed the point of the story that Watari, the author of the original light novels, is trying to tell. To be clear, I'm not trying to say that there's anything wrong with relating to Hachiman. In fact, when I watched Oregairu for the first time as a dumb teenager back in 2013, I too was in the camp of people who really liked and admired Hachiman and thought he was some really cool, swell dude. It's very easy to understand why people are drawn to Hachiman as a character. He's smart, adept at reading social situations, and seemingly incredibly self-confident in his loner lifestyle. It's really no wonder that this type of character resonates with a lot of the anime-watching community. On average, I would wager that the types of people who get really drawn to anime, especially from a young age, probably aren't the most, one could say, socially adept. Watching anime is definitely not something that quote-unquote normies do. A lot of this comes from my own personal experience growing up and watching Oregairu during my early teens. I was never really the type of person who had a lot of friends or was particularly good at socializing with people, two things that are still pretty true about myself. More specifically, I had the same sort of internalized lack of self-worth that Hachiman does. From a young age, I was constantly labeled by teachers and authority figures as a problem child with severe personality issues. On these same teachers' recommendations, I was shunted between social workers and child psychologists in an attempt to fix my antisocial behavior. At a certain point, I came to believe that there was truly something fundamentally wrong with myself, and that I was a bad person who would never be able to fit in and form normal social relationships. From the very first monologue Hachiman gives about youth being a lie, my teenage self was enamored with Oregairu. Watching Oregairu felt like watching someone who truly understood my situation. From a cynical outlook to the way he sits alone in the classroom with his headphones in, to the awkwardness that underpins much of his interactions with Yui and Yukino, Hachiman seemed like a character that just understood the type of life I had. I loved how Hachiman seemingly effortlessly maneuvered through social situations without caring at all how people saw him. I wanted so badly to be like Hachiman. Even though I was eventually able to make friends and even have romantic relationships, in retrospect, I think this desire to be someone who was aloof and didn't care for how other people saw me was ultimately detrimental to my ability to form genuine and meaningful relationships with others. I tried to build a facade like Hachiman. On the outside, I wanted to seem self-possessed, independent, and almost above other people. But on the inside, I was deeply insecure and wanted genuine relationships. Even if I couldn't articulate it back then, it was that internal conflict that likely drew me to Oregairu. I'm not going to claim to be some galaxy brain literary expert who understands every detail of what Watari is trying to convey, but when you look beyond the surface, it's fairly clear that Oregairu is not an endorsement of Hachiman's lifestyle. In fact, it's really much more of a ringing rebuke. All of the memes about Hachiman being Batman no doubt probably distorted people's view of the show. While the ape-man worship was certainly much more prevalent during the period in 2013 to 2015, where the second season hadn't yet finished airing, you could still see bits of the themes that are reinforced in season 2 in season 1. Consider why the Service Club even exists. The club's reason for being is to rectify Hachiman's belief system. Yukino and Hidatsuka both know that Hachiman is a problem and make the club to help him. If you go back to the very first episode, Hachiman is forced to join the club because he wrote some terrible Japanese essay. That seems like a pretty flimsy justification to force someone to join an extracurricular club against their will. Hidatsuka then waits outside the club room until she senses that Yukino is hitting a wall of trying to get Hachiman to join the club. She then conveniently reappears to make the bet between Hachiman and Yukino to see which of them can help the most people. A bet that is so important apparently that she completely forgets about it when it's brought up again in the second season. This all starts coming together when it's later revealed that it was Yukino's car that hit Hachiman on the first day of school. Undoubtedly, a part of Yukino's reason for starting the service club is guilt, but I think it goes beyond that. When you look back to the first episode, isn't it kind of odd that Yukino claims to have no idea who Hachiman is, but seems to have a perfectly good sense of who Yui is? The service club is created because Yukino watches the guy who threw himself in front of a car to save a total stranger's dog act like a friendless, cynical degenerate. Is it any wonder that she thinks something is grossly wrong with this guy? Hiratsuka is more than happy to play along because she knows better than anyone else that Hachiman's attitude is only going to make more problems for him in the future. Even though season 1 is generally considered to play more into the comedy aspect of my teen romantic comedy, if you look deeper, the core themes of the second season are already apparent. Despite his insistence to the contrary, Hachiman clearly has reservations with the philosophy he claims to unabashedly embrace. We see this most clearly after he confronts Sagami on the roof during the cultural festival. Hachiman sinks into the ground, he's clearly not pleased with himself. Hachiman embraces self-sacrifice as a way to solve problems, not because he enjoys being a social outcast or something. It's because he's internalized that it's worth constantly throwing himself under the bus because no one cares about him. Even though Hachiman's interventions at the summer camp or the culture festival are considered successes, has he really meaningfully made the situation better? He may have preserved Rumi's friend group in the short term, but when she reappears in the second season, she's back to being shunned by her peers. Sagami hasn't really learned anything from her abject failure as a cultural festival committee chairwoman. Hachiman is obsessed with preserving the status quo, even when that status quo goes directly against the value system he claims to follow. It's this fixation on preserving the status quo at the cost of himself that ends up being Hachiman's undoing in the second season. The Ebina confession arc is designed to demonstrate the contradictions and instabilities of Hachiman's belief system. Hachiman spends the entire first season monologuing about how much he despises fake relationships, but when push comes to shove, he sacrifices his own dignity to save Hayato's friend group, a friend group that, by Hachiman's own standards, doesn't deserve to exist if it can't handle Toby's confession to Ebina. Hachiman then spends the next episodes resorting to increasingly underhanded and manipulative tactics to get Itaha to win the student council election, under the guise that he's doing it to preserve the service club and the status quo. Yukino understands that if she wins the election, the three of them can just move to the student council. Fundamentally, nothing about their relationship would change, but Hachiman ends up prioritizing saving the room of the service club over his own integrity. Even though Hachiman tries to reassure himself that nothing is wrong and that he likes the direction that things are going, he knows deep down that things are very wrong. One of my favorite moments in the show was when Hachiman goes to the vending machine to buy Max coffee, only to change his mind and buy a different brand. Hachiman is simultaneous to try to convince himself that he is fine with change while signaling to the audience that something is grotesquely wrong with this situation. In a nutshell, Hachiman's belief system is fatally flawed, and his increasingly self-destructive and contradictory behavior in season 2 is designed to demonstrate that. But being the dumb 14-year-old that I was completely unable to recognize the myriad of problems of Hachiman's outlook, or even the message that the story was trying to convey. Oregairu is a story as heavily reliant on the reader to draw their own conclusions and to read between the lines. Much of the content and nuance is already lost in the transition from the light novel to the anime, of key scenes and details being left out. I think one of Watari's greatest strengths is how he's constructed Oregairu so different people could enjoy it on different levels. One way to experience Oregairu is to sift through the nuance and to deep dive into the characters and their interactions. Another way is to just enjoy watching Hachiman seem cool, while mentally deciding which girl you think is the prettiest. But herein lies the greatest irony with Oregairu. The people who would benefit the most from understanding Hachiman's character are also the least likely to be able to draw the necessary conclusions to understand the show on a deeper level. I know that when I watched season 2 as a still equally dumb teenager, I didn't get much out of it. I've only been able to really more fully appreciate Oregairu after rewatching it years later, after I've had time to mature as a person. One of the greatest revelations I've had rewatching the show is how I've come to better understand the deep flaws within Oregairu's cast. I can see the worst parts of myself within the character of Oregairu. I have Hachiman's relentless cynicism. Yukino's penchant for dependence and over-reliance on others, and Hayato's desire for approval. But what's changed between now and when I first watched Oregairu 5 years ago is that I'm self-aware of my own shortcomings as a person. But I would wager that your typical Hachiman idolizer is pretty young, probably middle or high school age. They probably don't have many friends, so naturally they latch on to the most obvious parts of Hachiman's character. That is, his hatred of nice girls and vapid youth relationships without thinking deeply about the narrative or having the self-awareness to see the flaws in Hachiman's worldview. If I haven't made it clear, I'm not trying to say there's anything wrong with being a loner, or that Oregairu idolizes being a normie or something. At his core, Hachiman is really just an average guy. We see this in his interactions with Komachi. He has nothing to prove around her. He doesn't have to pretend to be anything with her. Hachiman genuinely wanted to try to live a normal high school life, only for things to be horribly derailed on his first day. It's completely understandable for someone like Hachiman, who is constantly rejected and ostracized, to develop the jaded, cynical view on life that he has. Fundamentally, Hachiman cares about the people around him, but because of his warped views of himself, he can't bring himself to believe that others care about him. Because of that, he comes to believe that self-sacrifice is the best way to solve problems. Even though we can't see it, there are plenty of people in Hachiman's life who do care about him. From Yukino, to Yui, to Hiratsuka, to Totsuka, and his inability to see that ends up hurting these people who are the closest to him. If there's anything to be taken away from Oregairu, it's the importance of vulnerability and honesty in forming meaningful relationships. When I'm writing this, season 3 has only barely begun, so things could look dramatically different when the show ends. But there's no doubt there's an entire contingent of people who like Oregairu for the quote-unquote wrong reasons. On the one hand, I have a great deal of respect for Watari and the story he's trying to tell. In an industry saturated with mindless self-insert protagonists and brain-dead isekai plotlines, it takes a certain courage to write a story that beats to the sound of its own drum. But if someone watches Oregairu and comes away with the message that it's cool to be like Hachiman, and that there's nothing wrong with what he's doing, is that a failure on the part of Watari? If a writer is trying to convey a certain point or message, is the onus on the writer to make that apparent? As a more extreme example, let's take the 2019 film Jojo Rabbit, which is about a young boy growing up in Nazi Germany who has Hitler as an imaginary friend. If you've watched the movie, you would know that it in no way endorses Nazi ideology. To the contrary, it's a satirical critique of Nazism. But imagine if Jojo Rabbit was written in a way where a sizable contingent of the audience walks away with the message that it's cool to be a Nazi rather than it being tremendously evil. I think most people would agree that that would be a pretty substantial failure in the part of the film. To a much less serious degree, you have the same dilemma with Oregairu. The way that Watari has chosen to structure his story and the way that he's chosen to tell that story has led a sizable group of people to take the exact wrong message away from the story. And the great irony of this whole situation, as I said before, is that the people who need to internalize Watari's message the most are the same people who are the least likely to have the emotional maturity to see the necessary nuance to get that message. This creates a situation where even though Oregairu is incredibly well written and a compelling work of narrative fiction, I would also argue it fails from a thematic standpoint. I certainly think that at least a part of Watari's rationale for writing Oregairu was to serve as a cautionary tale, to discourage you from going down the same path of unbridled cynicism that Hachiman starts the series on. Ultimately, I think that the open question Oregairu leaves us with regarding authorial intent is another reason why I find this work so fascinating.